Hello there, members of the Inflatables class. This is Andy T. And I decided to do a slideshow with audio commentary. So that way, it's information that I wouldn't necessarily have to re-go over during class. So I'm going to try to not leave things out. And in class, we can maybe just talk briefly about your reactions to what you see. Here's just a random assortment of inflatable artwork, sculptures, installations, and I'm going to start here with Ant Farm, which is actually architecture. They're based out of San Francisco in the late 60s, early 70s, and they were interested in these sort of pop-up spaces, events. Now the word pop-up is used a lot in sort of foodie culture and sort of special events within brick-and-mortar venues. So this is quite literally pop-up and making your own venue. And so they're into having these rooms that they would oftentimes have an entrance sort of underneath the big bubble. So you'd kind of like crawl and then get into the bubble from below. And they would use a lot of gas-powered generators, which is not the most green, but it's kind of a precursor to the Burning Man sort of phenomenon of creating a venue. And so one thing they would do frequently is have a relatively two-dimensional kind of a flat profile and then puff it full of air. And to give the object shape, they would throw netting and ropes over it. They're using high-powered fans with the generator, so you can see that there are people climbing on top of the big sort of pillow object, which is in fact sort of what they titled this. They call this 50 by 50 pillow. So it's a 50 foot by 50 foot square times two that are then laminated together, filled with air. You can see the straps across the top. This is installed on the mountains. It's a beautiful picture. This is a picture from the same sort of pop-up piece, actually at the Altamont Music Festival that was put on by the Rolling Stones. And that's famous for, a number of people were murdered by the security guards. The Rolling Stones had hired the Hells Angels to be their on-site security. And there's a really interesting movie called Gimme Shelter, all about that, but Ant Farm was there. So this was the medical space. Why do people are naked? I'm not exactly sure. Maybe they're coming down from drug high. Who knows? And then here they are working with parachute material. And then creating sort of multiple unit spaces. And so you can see the drawings that they have for making different kinds of spaces using netting. And this is in the Inflato cookbook, which I've posted to our Canvas site. Then moving along, thinking about these sort of happenstance venues, these pop-ups, this fellow, Joshua Allen Harris, is actually a photographer and a advertising media person. So he's not a sculptor, but he's done a number of projects on New York City grates. There's lots of air coming out of the subway. So this is a project he did with the Brooklyn Friends School. It's a Quaker school. They do a summer arts program. And so he worked with them to really quickly sort of do these pop-ups. So here they're just taking two garbage bags, taping them together, and then the students are drawing on them, and they're these sort of huggable friends. So this is a video of Josh's preliminary work. Thank you. And then here is an additional video of his that is using the same piece, but you can see how he's using it more for his direct marketing and public service announcement approach. So this is about saving the polar bears. And then moving on, there's this Turkish-German artist, Iskender Yediler. I don't know if I'm saying that properly or not. But he has a number of sculptures and things that could count as installation, where they take up a lot of space, that are pretty fun and whimsical. There's some that are a little bit more serious. So this is like a pool party piece. Now, what's nice in the gallery space is you can sort of stand above it and look down at it because of that mezzanine that you see there. Here's a piece that is based around clouds, and we'll see something very similar a little bit later from Lee Borson. And this is done out of plastic. Lee Borson's work is done with sewn fabric. These pieces I really like, where Iskender is going shopping, finding detritus from shopping, and creating forms. So here it's easy to make a crucifix form with the different bags. here's a different piece that he titles International Shopping. And so it's basically just bags from different businesses that are labeled with different languages and sort of different ethnic or national identity, which is something really important for him as a Turkish-German artist. Turkey and many other European, North European countries have problems with immigrant communities not being treated as sort of full citizens. So here it's portrayed, all the bags are just taped together in a long tube, and then he ties it in a knot, a loose knot, so that way it can still inflate the air. He then takes the same piece, the same long tube, and then he takes it to a shopping mall, and here he has it sort of wrapping around different architectural elements. And then working with grocery bags, plastic grocery bags, something that I personally really enjoy a lot. There's this person, John Brummett, who he's currently a Detroit-based artist. He does a lot of things with audio and video and performance, but he did have this piece that he did an installation with. So these are all grocery bags that he tapes the sidewalls together, so that way all the openings are all in one orientation. So then he's able to sort of close the loop and inflate it. And I believe he's originally from Iowa or Nebraska, and so for him, he was excited about this piece being reminiscent of a big big piece of corn, you know, big corn cob. And you can see with the different colored bags, you know, kind of has a what people call Indian corn, or sort of a less domesticated form of corn. And along those lines, one of the most famous artists who works with inflatables is this performance artist, Pat Olesko. And the piece we're about to see is a project she did at University of Michigan. Within about a month, she put on this big theatrical performance. I have some issues with her work, or maybe a lot of issues with her work. She loves puns, which may or may not be interesting to Cleo and her interest in idioms. So Pat Olesko developed this piece called Gola Blurs Travels. So she's constantly changing, doing semantic shifts with words. But this is a really interesting piece that some of the students helped her come up with using grocery bags. In addition to that project that's activated by human movement, she has this project on the beach, which these are essentially just built off of the idea of butterfly nets and kites. And so there's different forms here. I know Forrest was talking about working with condoms. So it could also be working with the visual image of condoms. And this is a funny component of the piece where they're trying to put a condom on the penis shape. So this fabric, you know, again, there's a slight, the air is able to sort of be released, you know, through the seams a little bit, but also with this, since it's being activated by movement, when the performer is no longer making forward motion and shoving air into the opening, when it starts to relax with the effects of gravity, then the air sort of pushes back outwards that opening. So these are possible ways to approach the inflatable project, but they are also much more sort of demanding, and they take a little bit more planning about what you should do while you perform. Here you can see some of Pat Olesko's interest in politics and ideas of power and relationships to money. And of course, you can see her use of puns with missile and misled. And on the sort of blue militarized figure, you know, instead of bullshit, it says bush shit. Things like that. So, General Italia. So his name is Genitalia. Lots of fun little things in there. These are images from earlier performances, 20 years ago. So oftentimes she's creating set pieces, the staging and sort of her, supporting characters for her performances. She'll be the solo performer, but then she'll have these sort of automatons, these inflatable characters that she interacts with. This is a really nice piece. For those of you that are familiar with Wizard of Oz, you know, she's clearly utilizing that imagery. But I like the way it intersects with the architecture. This goes back to the Vito Acconci piece we saw in 14 Americans, where he's using the ladders sort of outside the window. So think about inside, outside. And what's nice about this is you don't really have to sort of complete the piece. You allow the architecture or existing structures around the inflatable to kind of facilitate the viewer completing the piece in their mind. Other performance projects. Here she's working with a suit that there's sort of an inside part of the suit that sort of fits her body, and then there's a second layer, a second skin to the suit that then that space between the inside and the outside layer get to inflate. And then, you know, just some of her projects on bigger scales, pretty fun and festive, a big birthday cake. A lot of her stuff has a political rhetoric to it, but what I appreciate about it is divorced from necessarily her dialogue and what she's talking about and the way she's contextualizing what she's doing. It is really sort of fun and festive and bizarre to look at. So it's really good at being eye-catching. And while she has your attention, then she has these sort of monologues and these kind of diatribes that, are very political in nature. Another earlier piece, she thinks a lot about portrayals of female versus male, masculinity, femininity, and just ideas of performance. So her characters that she's interacting with on the stage that she creates, can be used in different ways. These hands can be shaken, but the hands can also be there to sort of molest the performer. So she works with things both directions. This is a piece sort of talking about the rhetoric around World War II and Germany invading different countries and the discussions of a domino effect. That kind of rhetoric of, you know, if one country falls, then it's going to be a quick succession of other countries that will fall to German rule. But now, thinking about this in terms of Cold War, you know, on here, you know, she has East Germany and she has Romania. So the idea that the way that was used to fight communism in our own country, so the whole premise behind the Vietnam War, one of our longest wars, was that we were trying to keep Vietnam from falling in the hands of Stalinist communism and Maoist communism. Because if that fell, then all the other countries in Southeast Asia were going to fall. So it's this fun, wacky figures, but she's using political rhetoric. And then I don't know anything about this piece. It looks fun and festive. I like it that it's outdoors. It's not sort of hemmed in by architecture per se. It's creating its own architecture. It looks like these forms seem like there's a breast-like quality to some of them, kind of like Madonna's famous cone-shaped brassiere. There's also parts of it that look like Tinker Toys. So playing with ideas of rudimentary forms, our associations with them, being a child, having fun, being playful. And then this is a lesser-known artist, Jimmy Coonley, who I'm just going to show you one piece of his that I think relates, that's in the camp with Pat Olesko. However, his work is less theatrical in terms of having a script and staging. And so with this, he has this inflatable suit with all of these appendages in every direction. And then he crawls inside of it, as you can see here. And then these appendages sort of extend outward, and then he can't really relate to people. He can't touch to people. It's hard to talk to him. So you can see at the performance, he's here in his suit. And then there's the crowd sort of separate from him. And if you try to interact with him, you kind of get pummeled with these inflatable things. So it's funny, zany, also deals with being separate or being different from those around you. The other sort of major artist that I think of, you know, Pat Olesko's really well known for her inflatable work in a performance way. Lee Borson, I think, is becoming more well known, you know, as the sort of installation artist who uses inflatables as a primary means for making his work. So these are images from a piece that are up at Mass MoCA right now in Massachusetts, Massachusetts Museum of Contemporary Art. And so these are all done with ripstop nylon, like parachute material that are sewn. This is just kind of show you different qualities of it. As with Iskender, the Turkish-German artist earlier, who had a piece with clouds, Lee Borson, you know, can't help but sort of address the idea of air, volumes, changing shapes. So these are these sort of storm cloud, tornado-like spaces. You can see part of his blower up there at the top left. So these pieces are sort of attached to the ground. So inflating them maybe sort of comes from a counterintuitive way. So they're actually being inflated from this space above, and then they're sort of being bolted or screwed down with a panel onto the floor. A similar thing with that, he has these other inflatable pieces, again, referencing clouds, but then using these heavy sort of cast bronze shapes. In this case, he's got cherubs and other sort of idyllic iconography. And so the heavy metal forms are then lashed back and forth with a monofilament fishing line, and it kind of comes through these openings in the clouds. So he's referring to a lot of things sort of in art history. People talk about that sort of the sunlight peeking through the clouds, or the godlight peeking through the clouds. So this like cherubic figure, very reminiscent of like Bouguereau paintings and, you know, mid-1800s symbology. And this is another piece. I think this one's called Lucky Storm. So the metal shapes that are on the ground are actually profiles of shapes you would find in a bowl of Lucky Charms. And again, he's playing with, having fun with the monofilament. I love his use of monofilament here because most people try to use it to disappear. They want it to be invisible. And he is addressing very directly that, no, it is not invisible. It is not magic. But you could use it to recreate phenomenological experiences of light refracting off of, you know, moisture in the sky. So so I think he uses the monofilament in a very humorous and critical way with this kind of fun cloud piece. Other things involving the body. So an interest in sort of science and portrayals in science. Here we have a more simple piece that is using skin, a cross-section of skin. So you can see the different layers of dermis. And then we're sort of subverted. So the outside is kind of below. So instead of the skin growing kind of outward or upward, we see the hair follicles, blood vessels. The yellow areas are sort of fat, layers of fat in the skin. So trying to sort of look at ideas of skin and dermis are really important because the way the inflatable project works is it is a skin that's filled with stuff. So pretty interesting. And again, kind of fun looking at science from a new perspective. And then here's that cloud piece with precipitation, the blue areas shooting out. This is an older piece. So similar to the one that we saw before. And different angle, isn't it lovely? And then much earlier piece from like 2000. These are these kind of fun, you know, somewhere between a flower form or piece of furniture, and then the fan. You know, I like the use of the cords, like using the bright green extension cords that plug into the fan that inflate these objects. And so it's coming from above, but then the object sits on the ground. So it kind of plays with the idea of what you might want out of an inflatable or a balloon. When I was searching for images of his work online, I was really surprised to see, I know the guy in this photograph in the front right here, that's Japheth Minas. He's actually a really good painter based in Chicago. So that was funny to see him in this photograph. One of the last pieces I'll show of Lee Borison's. This is one of the projects that it is suspended from the ceiling, but this is one of those projects that I've mentioned where the inflation mechanism is tied to the building's own metabolic system. So the HVAC, when it kicks on, this thing sort of inflates and gets real puffy and has tension. And then when the HVAC, the heat, is turned off, then the elements kind of sag, but it's just above head height, so you don't really have to worry about that falling on people. So it still allows this to be a functioning lobby space. And then two quick projects. This is a UK, British-based street artist who goes by the name Filthy Lucre. I'm just going to show this one piece of his. He's got a lot of really great fun and kind of zany interjections into daily life. But I thought this was really strong in terms of its use of architecture, similar to the Pat Olesko piece with the Wicked Witch of the West feet sticking out of the building. Here he has these tentacles that he doesn't really need to fully articulate the octopus or squid form, really, you know, by letting us only see a portion of the piece, leaves a lot to the imagination. It's a really great detour from a person's sort of regular daily life. And so thinking about this as a possible strategy of having an inflatable piece sort of poke out of a door or a window, or limiting what people can see of it, could be a really interesting concept. And then Paul McCarthy, he's a very famous artist for making art about scatological things, lots of body, physical things that are sort of categorized as being gross or disgusting or impolite. So here's a very large poop, or David Flagel would call it a large scat, as he talks about studying wolf poops or scats. Similarly, here we have these two inflated pigs, you know, but one of the pigs is, you know, in process of being butchered, so its head is ripped off. Yeah, sort of having a dark sense of humor, trying to make the viewer sort of address more serious subjects in a playful way, which will then lead us to the last person we're going to look at is Stefan Sagmeister, who he is a graphic designer, and he's sort of one of the bad boys of graphic design, as people would call it. He does a lot of projects that are low-tech at times, that don't necessarily follow, they don't seem to follow certain rules or standards of graphic design. So he does a lot of art objects, photographs them, and that will become his page layout. And so we're just going to watch the first minute of this video. A warning, it's a TED talk. I'm obsessed. It's fine. But he talks about where his inflatable pieces are placed, and different ways to think about perceiving them, and how is the piece complete.
I was here about 4 years ago talking about the relationship of design and happiness, and at the very end of it, I show the list under that title. I learned very few things in addition since, but made a whole number of them into projects since. These are inflatable monkeys in every city in Scotland. Everybody always thinks they are right. They were combined in the media, drugs are fun in the beginning, but become a drag later on.
So that sort of ends this this little video session, but I just wanted to show you that Sagmeister piece, the idea that the pieces are cohesive, not necessarily in the physical experience of them, but being photographed and then published in a periodical is where the piece sort of becomes whole. So you'll be standing in one place and there'll just be a video, there'll be a giant inflatable monkey that says, right. And you can interpret that a bunch of different ways, you know. And then another inflatable monkey in a different place where it just says, always. You wonder, what does that mean, inflatable monkey? So inflatables, thinking about locations, what it could mean, thinking about shapes. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.